guys, just had Bishop Jamie Englehart on the podcast. It was just me and Jamie. Derek wasn't able to make the call. We had a little hiccup in this interview. We'd met on a Wednesday, got about 20 minutes in, and my internet went out. So we lost those 20 minutes, which were fire. But 2 days later, Jamie and I got back together, and we picked up where we left off on our original conversation. But without the earlier conversation, you're going to be thrown into the deep end. Guys, Jamie is brilliant. He's well-read. He's a relational theologian with an academic mind. I mean, the guy knows Greek, Hebrew, and probably 30 other languages. The man can quote scripture with the best of them. Brilliant mind, big heart, and a bit like a fire hose when he gets going. And he got going. We found ourselves connecting around our backgrounds, Pentecostal, charismatic, the nature of encountering God, and also much of the church's infatuation with the devil. In fact, the first half an hour, Jamie breaks down scripture talking about Satan and demons, and I just hung on for the ride. I think a lot of folks will be fascinated by this conversation, and I encourage you, like me, to hang on because this thing gets going. We talked an hour and a half, could have talked another hour and a half, and in that second half, he dove into union, grace. He dove into what it is to awaken to light, life, and love. He talked about 1 John in ways that fascinated me. He talked about how to approach scripture through the lens of sonship in the context of relationship with a father. He talked about perfect theology. Grace, we hit on grace. If the first half of the conversation stretches, he, like a good communicator, brings the whole thing home. So I encourage you to listen to the end. Jamie's an amazing fella, and I was absolutely honored to talk with him, and I think this podcast will encourage. As always, guys, please rate, review, share, and subscribe. Go to iTunes, leave us a review. If you want a little bit more from us, go to afamilystory.org, where you can sign up for our mailing list. You'll get articles and more information on the podcast. And please consider supporting us. This is a listener-supported podcast, and I'm incredibly thankful for all those who've participated in that way. Family Story is a 501. You can give one time or regularly, and you can do that at the same place, afamilystory.org. Okay, excited about this podcast. This is my conversation with Bishop Jamie Englehart. That sounds good to me. I don't think we'll have a problem with getting you to talk about something.
Yeah, I don't think there's a problem there. I tell young ministers all the time, like, you know, when you're getting ready to preach and, you know, everything, you know, I mean, how do you pray, everything else? And I said, listen, after 33 years, I said, I don't have to pray at all about what to say.
Right.
I said, I have to pray about what not to say. I said, after 33 years, man, I got plenty. I said, we got plenty to talk about. I've got all kinds of stuff in me, but normally it's like, man, you know, what should I be careful about not saying in this congregation? You know, it's definitely more along those lines.
Which is real. That's real for sure. Cause you got to know where you are, and you're looking for a yes in the room, what to speak to in the room. And the last thing you want to do is undermine that.
Yeah. And just one yes in the room, is it good enough? I'd prefer at least half the room.
Oh, dude, I have a feeling that you're able to navigate that well too.
I've learned how to do that through the years.
It's good to have you, man. It's really good. To do this. We tried it a couple of days ago, got cut off by my internet going down, so we get to do it again. We were about 20 minutes in. Jamie Englehart, man, I am so glad to have you on this podcast. A mutual friend, Matthew Hester, who is the guy that started telling me about you, and I realized when he was telling me about you, I'm friends with this guy on Facebook, and this guy's fire. This guy's speaking things that are brilliant and also doing it with grace. So thrilled to have you on the podcast, man. Tell the people a little bit about yourself. I want to dive into the new book. It's very in line with what this is about, Rethinking God. And but just share a little bit about yourself, the ministry, Connect International.
Sure. Well, first of all, thanks for having me. Anytime I get asked to do something like this, I do take it as an honor. I don't ever just blow that stuff off. It still blows me away how people around the world actually are interested in what I have to say. You know, I grew up in a little town preacher's kid in northern Michigan, way up in northern Michigan, not the UP, but as far as you can go before you, you know, get that much higher. And
you're in Canada, basically. Yeah,
pretty close, you know. And so, you know, and a third generation Pentecostal preacher on one side of the family, second generation on the other. My grandmother helped, you know, start churches all over mid-Michigan in the 40s in what they called Brush Harbor meetings. You know, they were kicked out of the churches, so they'd go out and clear a spot in the woods and tarry for the Holy Ghost, you know.
Oh, my gosh, man. That's awesome.
All that. Yeah, my grandma, she was something else, to say the least. And, of course, huge influence on my life when it comes to the experiential and the encounter side, which I think is still extremely important, you know, for us to experience. I'm just glad that I had the experience side before I got my theology right.
Right.
Just because sometimes you go down the road, the roads of what people called reconstruction or deconstruction. Sure. Yeah. And if there's not been, you know, true experiences, man, it can lead people just away from the faith.
Yeah.
And that's just never even been a thought.
Yeah.
In my mind, I've experienced too much, but, my wife and I married, we just started our 33rd year.
Yeah,
in ministry and marriage, have two amazing kids. My daughter, she's a worship pastor at our home church here. Now we moved from Michigan 3 years ago down here to Southern Indiana, the Louisville area, just because our daughter took our granddaughter and moved down here. Right. And so our house went up for sale, and we followed pretty quick because I travel full time. You know, my wife let me know, I can live where, you know, you can do whatever you want to do from wherever we can live anywhere in the country. So we're going to be by the grandbabies. And, so, and then her husband's great young man, now two granddaughters. And we actually were able to buy the house next door to him.
Right.
So our grandbabies are 60 feet from us, and it's heaven.
You're living the dream, man. You're living the dream.
And we love it. And then my son, he's a producer, an artist. He's got a bunch of stuff online, Brandon Sozo. That's his tag.
Nice.
He does a little bit of rap, R&B, everything you can imagine. His wife, Shai, she's amazing. We got an incredibly mixed family. My daughter's last name is Rocha. And so, you know, we got some Mexican in the family. And then my daughter-in-law, her name is LaShyla.
Okay.
And you know, she's African American, and she's an absolute amazing young woman. And so all my grandbabies, once they start having babies, we're gonna have nothing but beautiful babies. And so my two granddaughters are absolutely gorgeous. And
that's awesome.
You know, our life started a church, inner city of Saginaw, Michigan, Saginaw per capita, most dangerous city in America for probably the last decade. That was 11 years ago. Led that 4 years, turned it over to a young man 18 years ago, almost 19 now, started to lead a network of churches. And that's what keeps me, you know, super busy, to say the least. Love serving pastors and leaders, and, you know, been to now drag my family. They used to travel with me 43 states, took them to seven nations. I've been to 14 now, literally, you know, all over the world. So
that's
a little bit about what we do.
Yeah. Love the gravel in your voice. We talked about that last time we talked.
Yeah, that's called overuse.
I love the story. Let's start with you talked about the presence. I'm similar. I grew up in the charismatic Pentecostal. My grandmother, West Coast, literally revival meetings, you know, we're talking British Columbia, Canada. They would go up into the interior and they would have these meetings in the summer. And I never met her. She died when my dad was five, but I hear all the stories about the Dalgettys and the fire there. And the thing that I've said so often as a dad of my kids is that, you know, I want my kids to experience an encounter with the names of God before they start to study the interpretation, because that guides that encounter, that real felt love of God, which is what it is. That's the language that would guide them.
Yeah.
Otherwise, like you said, they get sideways real quick with these interpretations that have nothing to do with the love of God.
Yeah. Well, and I you know, I think right now too, it's like the last 20 years in a lot of the just the church itself, you know, we've had kind of a re-emphasis on Jesus at the center,
yeah,
which like grace has exploded on the scene.
Come on.
Because grace is a person. It's not an entity. It's not a thing. But what we've had now is we've had, and I've been saying this for the last probably 4 years, we've gotten our orthodoxy correct, which is our belief systems. It's like,
yeah,
people are finally starting to preach the new, yeah, covenant, you know? I mean, actually, yeah, believing, we've been there for 2,000 years, but we're just finally figuring out that that's where we're at. And starting to get our orthodoxy right, but our orthopraxy,
right,
the practice of it, we've got a whole generation now that haven't had those encounters.
Right.
You know, yeah, like I've been sharing a message since the beginning of this year out of 1 Timothy chapter 2, where Paul said that it's God's will, God's desire that all be saved. And we normally stop there.
Yeah.
But then he goes on to say, and come to the knowledge of the truth.
Yeah.
And so we've got a lot of saved people who've never come to the knowledge of the truth, because, wow, the word knowledge there in the Greek is epigenosko, and it literally is translated firsthand encounter or, wow, firsthand experience.
Wow.
And so, you know, it's the reason why Paul also told Timothy that men would ever be learning and never coming to the epigenosko of the truth.
Come on.
And so, you know, you can get all your theology right. You know, I mean, to me, it's a picture of Saul to Paul. You know, now we know Saul wasn't quote unquote saved, because across, you know, I mean, that whole thing, he was under law. But in most churches in America, if a Saul was in a church, most parents would tell their sons and daughters, you need to be like Saul. I mean, Saul went to church every Saturday.
Yeah.
You know, he was zealous for God. He was at every prayer meeting. I mean, man, he's learning with the pastors and all the bishops and the Sanhedrin. I mean, Paul is, man, he is an example.
Right.
And he was learning all this stuff, but he never met Jesus, you know? And so, yeah, it's that whole, I like to use the example of, you know, Isaiah is a prophet of woe for 6 chapters. You know, because he's prophesying from the earth. So he looks at what's going on in the earth.
Yeah.
And his whole message is, whoa, whoa, whoa. But all,
oh
of
my
a sudden,
gosh, bro. Yeah.
He gets caught up into the heavens, you know. And, yeah, if you sit around and watch Fox News, MSNBC, CNN,
yeah,
you're going to be a prophet of woe, you know, because all they're telling is bad news.
Yeah.
But when he gets in the heavens and he gets to the mercy seat, the seraphim are flying around the throne and they're saying, holy, 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 the earth is full of glory.
Right.
And it's like, well, wait a minute. How can it be full of woe and full of glory at the same time?
Right.
So, you know, in God's mind, this earth is already full of glory.
Bro.
But what it's not full of is the prophet said that the earth shall be filled, not with the glory of the Lord, but the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory.
Wow.
Because it's not till I encounter that glory,
yeah,
and I awaken to,
wow,
it, that I then experience that it's real to me, right, subjectively.
Yeah.
You know, it's like objectively, the earth is already full of glory. I mean, I don't need to go get in the glory. I don't need to go try to find it.
Right.
The earth is full of the glory
That's
of the Lord, because everything is in him.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you can't function outside of him.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean, you know, it's like Paul getting up on Mars Hill and saying to pagans, they're all in Christ.
Yeah.
In him you live, in him you move, in him you have your being.
Yep.
For we're all God's offspring.
Yeah.
But then for Paul to say about, you know, Phoebe and her husband, they were in Christ before I was.
Yeah.
It's like, Paul, what are you talking about? You just got up and told a bunch of pagans they were all in him, in Christ.
Right.
They live and move and have their being in him. But then you're saying these people were in Christ. Well, of course, when Paul would be saying that, Paul would be talking about they gnoskoed him before.
Right.
They gnoskoed him before he did. You know, in other words, objectively, all are already there. But subjectively, it's having that knowledge of the truth.
Right.
You know, it's more than just, okay, I prayed a prayer and I got saved. There's all kinds of people that attend churches that prayed a prayer and they believed in their heart, but they've never had that encounter. And to me, it's the encounter that solidifies. You know, it's like I've got good friends of mine that don't believe in demons. Okay. They're like, well, you know, that's just psychosomatic and I don't know where you are and it's cool. I mean, you know, it really don't matter to me. And I've got guys that can break down the Greek for me and say, well, you know, this is just talking about some mental thing. And I'm like, listen, man, this is all I know is when I was 20 years old in the best shape of my life, benching over 350 pounds, I'm in the interior of Mexico, in this little town. And I'm standing in the front row. And the man I was learning and traveling with at the time, he's up ready to start preaching. He's reading his text. And I see something out of the corner of my eye And I look down and it's a 7-year-old girl who's barely 40 pounds soaking wet. And she's slithering down the middle aisle on her belly on a dirt floor like a snake, which physically you just can't even do that. I mean, like on dirt. I mean, if you try to get your body to do that, man, I mean, you know, you're kind of pushed forward with your feet and everything else. And I look up at the platform and he looks down at me and he says, Jamie, take care of that. And, you know, I was 20 years old. I'm doing an internship. I'm like, you take care of that. You know, I'm like, man, I'm here to watch you.
Right.
And so, you know, I grab hold of this little girl and I start praying for her. And man, she rises up and starts throwing me all over that church.
Wow.
And I'm like, well, listen, you know, okay, let's say theologically you can explain that away. I'm just telling you.
Experientially.
You know, yeah, I mean, I experienced this, right. You know, and you can tell me that it was adrenaline. I'm just telling you right now, a 7-year-old who's 40 pounds. I mean, I was 210 solid pounds. Right. All right. I mean, and strong. And man, she threw me around like a little rag doll. You know, it's like the man that Jesus heals. And the Sanhedrin bring him in. He'd been blind from birth. Then they start questioning him. Then they bring his parents in and they're asking him questions about Jesus's doctrine. And finally he gets frustrated. He's like, listen, man, I don't know about none of that. All I know is once I was blind,
yeah.
Now I see.
Right.
And you know, it's hard to argue with someone that's right. Had an experience because you can't talk me out of that.
Yeah. There's like 7 things that I made points of now. Let's see if I can hit a few of them. Because some of what you're talking about is, well, I'm throwing back to a conversation we had that got recorded and didn't get.
Right.
So I'm having to navigate, okay, how do I ask this in a way that fits with what we're talking about? A couple of things first. Right off the bat, you've made the statement. I've heard this statement before. It really lines with me that if the me of 5 years ago ran into the me of today,
yeah.
that I would think the me of today is a heretic. I've added to that this thought, but I would really like the me of today. Like I would want to turn out like the me of today because of the fact that the me of today is more confident in his affection, more confident in his love, so on and so forth. That's the rethinking thing because what you just talked about, I know you've got a class called Awakening or
Awaken Academy. Yeah.
Awaken Academy. And so
e-courses
that you're talking about Awaken Academy. And some of what you just described about the nature of Paul's interaction and you're talking about something that some folks might use the word universal because you're describing something that we're awakening to. It's a little bit different. And then there's the mystery of the reality of the supernatural that you just kind of ended on where you're talking about the mystery of, man, I don't know what all that looks like. I know that there's that first question in your book of 70 misconceptions where you're talking about Lucifer I'd love for you to just go ahead, man. Take over.
Sure. Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, for anybody interested, I wrote a book called Myths and Mistranslations. And, you know, for me, it was over 50 years of questions that I had. You know, so the beginning of the book, the first one I came out with is the first myth is that Lucifer's not the devil.
Right.
And, you know, but, you know, part of the other thing, even what we were just talking about, the thing that amazes me is we automatically put the devil and demons always in the same category. But according to Hebrews chapter 2, that Jesus came to bring many sons to glory. And it says, and he came and destroyed him who had the power of death. That is the devil. He didn't just come to destroy death. He came to destroy him who had the power of death. That is the devil. And so literally Hebrews says the devil's been destroyed.
Right.
And so when people read that, but then they think that like the devil is like the general of hell and then the demons are, and we actually don't have the devil and demons having anything to do with each other when it comes to like an army. That's like all, it's all eisegesis. It's all read in, you know, I mean, one of the myths in my book is that hell is the headquarters of the devil and demons. And the truth is that they've never been there. I mean, we're told in Matthew that hell was made for them, but that was a future thing, depending on your eschatology and depending on if you believe that was talking about the high priest and the Levites in 70 AD, which there can be discussion that way. But But it says that the Satan goes about on the earth seeking whom he may devour. He's the prince of the power of the air. Nowhere does it actually say he's ever been in hell, just that he had the keys or he had like the authority. And so I think we automatically, like when we read the verse where Jesus said the gates of hell will not prevail against the church, people automatically think, oh, my gosh, you know, he's talking about the devil and demons. But the word hell there is Hades. It's grave.
Right.
He said the grave won't be able to come against the church. In other words, all Jesus was telling Peter and the disciples is no matter what people do to you, even kill you, you're never going to die because the grave, the grave is not going to be able to destroy you or come against you.
Right.
Because I'm getting ready to go into the grave, empty it out, lock the door from the inside. And now I've got the key. So all this goes down to, you know, this idea of Lucifer. That, you know, Lucifer's not the devil. Now, is there a devil? Was there a devil? Is there a Satan, Hasatan, which, you know, in Judaism, there wasn't a Satan until like almost 15 years into Judaism. You know, I mean, which is why you have in Samuel where it says that God told David the number Israel. And 400 years later in Chronicles, scribes are looking at that same story and they write down Satan told David the number Israel. And they're telling the same story. So was it God or was it Satan? Well, the truth is it was both, because when it was written in Samuel, they had no Satan. So they literally believe the first 1,000 years or more in Judaism, if it was good, it came from God. If it was bad, it came from God. That's why Job would say the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Now, we know the Lord wasn't taken away. It was Satan that was doing it. But we know the backstory. All right. So, you know, we know there was something else going on. They didn't know it. So that's why 1 Samuel 14 can say, I, the Lord, never take life. I, the Lord, never take life.
Right. Right.
I devise ways to bring my wayward ones home. But then like 8 chapters later, God opens the earth, swallows and kills 5,000 people. It's like, wait, what the heck? You know, I mean, like, what's going on there?
Right.
But what happened was an earthquake took place.
Right.
A bunch of people died and they blamed God for it because they believed that God creates good and evil. That's what Isaiah said, but that was before they had a devil. So over that 400-year period between Samuel and Chronicles, their theology changed. Huh. And they began to embrace that there was a being called Hasatan, the Satan, or the devil. And if it was death and destruction and negative, it was this Satan doing it. And if it was good, it was God doing it. So when the scribes look back 400 years later, they look back at that and they're like, well, you know what? When David did that, a bunch of people died. So God didn't tell him to do that. Satan.
Right. Wow.
and so, you know, that's why the scriptures don't have to confuse us if we understand that they were a progressive revelation and people were growing in their understanding.
Right.
You know, but this whole idea of Lucifer, man, this is a myth. I mean, it's crazy. And this is the funny part. You can Wikipedia Lucifer, literally as simple as, you know, and I'm not saying Wikipedia has all truth, obviously, but you can put the name Lucifer in Wikipedia and it will actually say that Lucifer is the star Venus.
Right.
Now, the only reason we get Lucifer is found one time in scripture and only King James and New King James.
Okay.
Because they use the Latin codex. And so the word Lucifer is the English of the Latin word for the morning star, which is the star Venus. And so that's why newer translations actually say day star or morning star. And of course, I think it's interesting that Jesus is called the day star.
Right.
So it's, you know, if the law and the prophets spoke of him, I don't think the law and the prophets are speaking of the devil. I think if we're going to find typologies, we probably ought to look more for Jesus and stuff than the devil and stuff. But again, it's found one time and it's not in the original Hebrew. It's not in the original text. And then when you go to Isaiah 14, you know, if I always tell people this, I said, if you want it to type someone other than Nebuchadnezzar, because historically it's talking about Nebuchadnezzar. All right. So it's talking about an actual king. All right.
Okay.
If you want it to type really someone, Adam would fit a whole lot better than a devil, simply because we don't have any example that angels have really free will. I mean, we have an example where it says they left their first estate, but what exactly does that mean? You know, God made man in his image and likeness. He didn't make angels in his image and likeness. And so only someone in his image and likeness. I mean, Paul even says angels long to understand what we understand. They long to look into the mystery. You know, one of the myths in my book also says this. You know, I was taught my whole life that when one sinner repents, all the angels in heaven rejoice. But it actually doesn't say that in Scripture. It says there's rejoicing in the presence of angels. Why would angels rejoice? They've never been lost. They don't know what it means to be found. They don't understand salvation. Paul says they long to look into the mysteries of salvation because they've never had to experience it. And so, you know, who's in the presence of angels? It's Zephaniah 3:17. The Lord thy God in the midst of thee is mighty. He will save. He'll rejoice over you with joy. He'll shout over you with singing. That literally every time someone awakens, they repent, they change their mind. The Father and the Son, the divine dance, the perichoresis that's going on in the heavens, is it's a party constantly.
Right.
You know, it's God's not some Zeus sitting on a throne with a long beard, because that word in Hebrew in Zephaniah 3:17, where he will rejoice over you with joy, literally means he will leap up and spin uncontrollably with great emotion. And so, like, you know, God's up in heaven, man, just dancing constantly because people are constantly awakening to the reality of his life, you know, and his glory. And so we get these whole ideas. And I like to tell people this, and then I'm going to give you a minute to ask me a question. As I see, I'm on a flow. Let me just finish quick.
Yeah.
But the whole idea where we don't have any example in Scripture of a genesis of the devil other than Jesus saying that the devil was a father of lies and was a liar from the beginning. Notice he didn't say he was an angel who became a liar. He was a liar from the beginning. Of course, the question would then be, you know, the beginning of what? And Jesus didn't say, I saw Lucifer fall from heaven. He said, I saw Hasatan, I saw Satan fall from heaven. And it said he was always a liar. So he didn't say, I saw an angel fall. And so even the whole idea, it says he comes as an angel of light, but even the devil as a fallen angel, that's more like Greek mythology.
And
I mean, there's just so much mythological stuff that we've put in our Christianity that you can't find stuff for. It's crazy.
Right. This is more time on Satan and the devil that I've spent in the entire last year.
Amen. Yeah. I don't talk about it a lot either.
but it's fascinating. And we've had this conversation, and I'm going to put a pin in a thought and come back to it, but we have had this conversation, before, and we've had a couple previous conversations, where you talked about this in the context of the devil and its connection to ego. Yeah. And one of the things that I shared with you, and I've told you, I'm not an academic. Like, you've already just, I did everything I could hanging onto my seat just to follow along with what you're saying. But what I shared with you, and we've, I know this is how you're wired, is for me, and you shared a story about it. Someone who came to you and you were interacting with him, I think an atheist friend or someone, maybe an agnostic. But for me, when I hear you talking, even the story about that little girl in Mexico and that interaction, I've seen things myself. I've navigated this world. It's a broken and fallen world. But I know this. I know that when things start to get sideways and I can't quite make it out, that five-year-old who's now almost a 50-year-old me, my fallback place is this relational dynamic, you know, that Jesus came to reveal the Father. I'm a relational theologian, is what I'm trying to say. Yeah, I'm not much of an academic. So I can step back and go, okay, what's Jamie talking about? Here's what I do know, how a father moves because of how Jesus revealed the Father and what grace looks like, and that light is greater than darkness, and that we're not having a conversation about a devil that's so big suddenly I have to go to war, that my whole life shifts into this fear paradigm of I got to go to war. Because the other side of that Pentecostal, this conversation is the part that I grew up with, where suddenly my whole prayer life is about beating a devil.
Absolutely.
That Jesus already beat at a cross.
Yeah.
Regardless of whether my education lines up and I'm confused about a third of the angels fall. Like, what, one of the things that fascinated me, what you said last time we talked, is that third of an angel's falling with Satan, or from or from heaven. It doesn't even exist. You got to go to Revelation and you got to interpret and get. And I'm like, man, that's crazy, because I grew up with that.
Right.
But the perichoresis that you're talking about, that's the thing that has most settled my heart when I start to have these conversations that go deep into, man, what do you do with that little girl? Like, what do you do? Right. I know light is greater than darkness, but I've been in moments where I've seen great darkness.
Yeah.
And I know that my theology, my understanding is catching up with this, that love is greater than anything else, that light always wins over darkness. So speak to that.
Right. Well, and what I would say is this, I mean, we're mainly talking about Old Testament stuff.
Right.
Because Hebrews chapter 2 said he's been destroyed. Right. I mean, to me, the devil's a non-entity.
Yeah.
Right now.
Right.
I don't even have to think about it, but you know, much of the church is still, you know, I preached a message years ago called An Unholy Infatuation with a Snake in the Holy Place.
Yeah.
And you know, in the wilderness, when the people needed to be healed, God had Moses take and put a brazen serpent on a pole and put it up in the air. And everybody that looked at the serpent, they were healed, which, of course, was a type of Jesus on the cross. Right. But that's the only example of a serpent that was different than being the devil.
Right.
Because it's nearly always, normally snakes are not referred to godly.
Right. You know,
it's normally all very negative. But then 400 years later, a young king by the name of Hezekiah walks into the Holy of Holies. And there's only two things that made it into the promised land. There was dead bones that made it into the promised land and the brazen serpent.
Huh.
Right. And 400 years later, the brazen serpent is in the Holy of Holies and they're offering incense to it. Now, the only thing left in the Holy of Holies is all God. It's all gold.
Right.
And they had a piece of brass. Brass is for the inner and the outer court. There's not supposed to be any brass in the Holy of Holies. And Hezekiah walks in, grabs it, takes it outside, smashes it, and says it's just a piece of brass.
Huh.
And I said, when I was growing up, you know, we'd start every service with testimony service. And we had an unholy infatuation with the snake. Well, the devil really been after me this week. Bless his holy name. I mean, you know, I mean, it was like the devil was doing everything. I mean, I grew up thinking the devil was more powerful than God was.
Right.
Than just grab that brazen serpent, smash it.
Right.
It's just a piece of brass. In other words, it's a resounding gong. It's a clanging cymbal. It's, you know, it's the opposite of love.
Yeah.
You know, there's no life to it.
Yeah.
And so now that he's been destroyed, but what I tell people is this, the devil has been dealt with, but demons at the cross were not. When it says he spoiled principalities and powers, that's not talking about demons. Principalities and powers were literally the ruling principalities of that era. Because when you get to Paul in Corinthians, Paul says that the principalities and powers of Jesus's day, if they would have known who he was, they wouldn't have crucified him. Well, that can't be talking about demons, because demons knew who Jesus was. You know, Jesus, we know. Paul, we know. Who are you? You know, have you come to torment us before our time? I mean, demons always knew who Jesus was. They weren't questioned by that. But the principalities and powers that's talking about was Caiaphas, who was the principality, the ruler of the religious system, Herod, the ruler of the economic system, and Pilate. All right. And so what Jesus overthrew was the ruling. I mean, to this day, if you go downtown on the town where you live in and you pull up to the courthouse, that's called a principality.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And so I remember, man, in the 90s, I took a whole Saturday class on principalities and powers. And I mean, there were general demons and colonel demons. And I mean, dear God, man, I mean, by the time we got done, I mean, we were looking for demons under every rock.
Right.
And
yet
principalities and powers in scriptures are rarely actually just talking about like demonic floating around things. It's literally, you know, like ruling systems. And Jesus himself came, overthrew all of that.
Yeah.
But demons, even after the cross, were still functioning. They were still casting demons out of people afterwards. And so, which I would call those familiar spirits, which mainly are family bents, family lies, things that get passed down.
Okay.
You know, 25 years ago, I would have called them curses. I stay away from that today.
Right.
You know, Jesus redeemed us from the curse.
Yeah.
But there's still a reality of an enemy of our soul out there that tries to harass.
Yeah.
And it's separate from the devil. You know, I mean, again, we just think the devil's the general leading this army, and that he's been dealt with.
Yeah.
You know, and so I hardly ever talk about like the devil, other than trying to get people to understand Lucifer's not the devil. A third of the angels did not fall from heaven. He doesn't rule hell. You know, he's not omnipresent.
Right.
You know, I mean, you know how many times I've had people say, oh man, this last week, the devil was really after me. I'm like, really? I'm like, so there's 7 billion people on the planet, and the devil, even in the Old Testament, can only be one place at one time. If he is an entity. You know, which of course there's arguments about that, because early Judaism taught devil was ego. It was a mindset.
Right.
And it's never a noun. It's nearly always like a verb. Right. It's an action.
Right.
And, you know, when Jesus turned to Peter and said, get thee behind me, Satan, he didn't literally become an incarnation of the devil. You know, what he was saying is, you know, what you're saying right now is adverse.
Yes.
It's satanic according to the purpose of God in my life.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I'm constantly trying to defame, if you may, this idea of the devil, because we've made the devil in the church almost on par with Jesus.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I said, now Santa may know when you're sleeping and know when you're awake, but the devil doesn't. Satan, you know, so just move that N and that T around, you know, but I mean, we pretty much taught Satan was just like Santa Claus.
Yeah.
You know, he knows everything about you.
Yeah.
And it's like, so you've done so much harm against the kingdom of darkness that the devil himself, you know, showed up to your house this last week.
Yeah.
Boy, don't you think highly of yourself? You know, I mean, it's like, you know, come on, let's think this stuff through a little bit.
Guys, the book is out, Leaving and Finding Jesus. I'm so excited about it. In this book, we trade a punishing God for reconciling love. We exchange the lens of retribution for the transforming revelation of God in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. Wherever you are on the journey, I really believe this book will encourage you. So it's available now on Amazon or at our website, familystory.org. Buy it. Buy multiple copies. Share it. And then do me a favor. If it's blessed you, write a review on Amazon. Guys, I'm so thankful for you. So thankful to be on this journey with you, praying life and joy and wonder over you today. All right, let's get back to the podcast. Reality is this is the world I grew up in,
yeah,
where there was a lot of talk about the devil, talk about, I mean, even the fact that our conversation got cut off several times. There have been times when someone would come along and say, man, the enemy must not want this to happen.
Right. Right. Rather than just the internet went down and that actually
happened. Yeah. Right. Yeah. I'm a long way from that. This is the verse that for me has been helpful, where the eye is healthy or pure sees truly, the body's full of light.
Come on.
Where the eye is unhealthy, the body's full of darkness. If then the light within you, and this is a piece that's pretty fascinating to me, if then the light within you, by the way, where does the light reside? It's still there within you. I don't know. I've never heard anybody talk about that, but I'm like, if then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? Which then comes back to, for me, this is how I've had to navigate. This is how I navigate really simply. Jesus's perfect theology was a foundational thing for me to go, duh, how did I miss that? But it was, and that God is good. And then in that context of trust, my lens then is, I don't know, but he's good. I'm going to lean into Jesus is what he looks like. And so for me, even these conversations, I'm like, man, like not a lot of people are going to be able to study to the extent that you've studied. It's good to sit under your study, but for me to navigate day in, day out, I'm like, ma'am, is my eye pure today? Meaning, am I seeing truly who he is? Because if I'm seeing truly who he is, then my body is full of light, and where there's light, there is no darkness. And how do we navigate in that way? And I think I would transition a little bit. I'd like you to take this and then talk about supercalifragilisticexpialidocious grace.
Yeah.
If you would, but that's kind of, for me, that practical, who is God? What is he like? Jesus came to reveal a father, reveal what he was like. And suddenly the whole world is flipped darkness. Well, there's so much of it.
Right.
Go ahead, man.
Well, and for me, it all comes down to, I think one of the key verses for me in the whole of scripture is 1 John 1:5. And John says this is the message not a message. John said, this is the message from him. So he's like, I hung out with Jesus for 3.5 years, 24/7, 365, was always by his side. And when I walked away, I've got a sentence that I pulled away of everything else he taught me. This is the one thing. This is the message. That should cause us to perk our heads up. So, I mean, when someone like John the Beloved, who was always the closest to Jesus' heart, said this the is the message. Loves. And the message that we learn from him is that his Father is light. And in him, there's no darkness at all. Man, now there's not an ounce of darkness. And so, you know, what I've walked people through in teaching that is I have to then walk them through the Old Testament.
Right.
Because we believe that God is light.
Right.
But then we were also raised to believe that he's still got a little bit of a dark side.
Sure.
You know? Yeah. But I mean, yeah, he's light, but you know what? He's the Greek God Janus.
Right.
You know, I mean,
right.
He turns his head this way and he's smiling and this way and he's angry, or he's Tommy Two-Face from Batman.
Right.
You know, I mean, he's happy one minute. He's ticked off the next minute. That's just who God is.
Right.
And so I have to walk them through and actually then show them that in the Old Testament, things that got attested to God were actually Hasatan.
Okay.
And they weren't God, because God got blamed for all kinds of stuff he had nothing to do with.
Yeah.
You know, and I like to think in my mind, I said, I wonder when Jesus told John this. And, you know, when I read scripture, it's just how my mind works. I'm like, I think it was probably when John and James and Jesus were preaching an evangelistic crusade and a couple cities don't receive Jesus. And James says, hey, let's call fire out of heaven and just slaughter them all.
Yeah, right.
You know, and by the way, just a little nugget there. It's not an accident. It's recorded as James and John, not John and James, because James is actually in Greek and Hebrew, James is actually Jacob.
Oh,
and it literally means removed by or supplanted by. Huh. And then John is translated grace. So anytime you remove or supplant grace, you want to call fire out of heaven and kill everybody.
Wow, bro.
Okay.
Wow.
You know, I mean, and so, you know, that's why there's no accident on the Mount of Transfiguration. It was Peter, James, and John in that order. It's never John, James, Peter, John. It's Peter, James, and John. Peter means a stone.
Yeah.
James means supplanted or removed by, and John means grace, because the stone removes grace. Wow. The law removes grace.
Right, right.
Okay. And so there's no accident why when Jesus rises from the dead and he says, go tell the disciples and Peter takes off running, but John takes off running too. And John gets there before Peter does. But John stands outside. He doesn't go in the tomb. Peter does. And I remember years ago, I asked the Holy Spirit, I said, man, what is up with that? Why did Peter run into the tomb and John didn't? And man, all of a sudden it hit me that Peter, the stone, the law is swallowed up in the death, burial, and resurrection. But John, grace, is the one always pointing the way, that this is the way to life. Wow. It's the law has to get swallowed up.
I just thought John was faster and Peter was bolder, but I like your take.
And there was that too, you know. And, it's not either or, it's both.
I love it.
And, but
I love that.
But it's interesting once people get an understanding of that according to John 1, no man has seen God at any time until Jesus, who came from the Father, revealed him. And what you said a few moments ago, John said, not only is God light, but he is the light of all men.
Jeez. Yeah.
So that means in every human, there's the light of God. Yeah. There's that imagio Deo. Yeah. There's no accident why. Yeah, and this is the crazy thing to me, man. What's amazing to me is how many years I was in church and never remember a sermon that probably should perk us up more than anything else when we read it. And that's Paul in Colossians saying there's a mystery that's been hidden from the ages. I mean, you'd think, I mean, a mystery hidden from the ages would be something to say, man, you know what? We probably ought to pay attention to that. And that ought to really perk us up, because we should be excited about those mysterions. You know, I mean, that should be an exciting thing. Yeah. And then he goes on to say what the mystery is. He said the mystery is given to the church for Gentiles. And the mystery is Christ in you, not Christ to you.
Yeah.
Christ in you, the hope of glory, because he's the light of all men. And so, you know, I've been saying this now for more than probably 20 years, that our job as preachers is not to preach to the sin in people, because God's not even counting men's sins against them.
That's right.
I mean, God's not focused on
he's
sin.
He's not in the sin counting game. Yeah.
Right. I mean, one of the myths in my book is that God can't look on sin.
Right.
Which, you know, I mean, literally, it doesn't exist in scripture. There's one verse in Habakkuk, and it says, God, you're so holy and you're so righteous. How can you look on evil?
Right.
And we'll say, see, God can't look on sin. But then there's a comma. Right. And the rest of the verse says, so why do you?
Right.
You know, I mean, you know, yeah. Which of course you've probably heard it said before, you know, that a text out of context is a con, you know, and of course, you know, we've been conned to believe all kinds of stuff.
No kidding, man.
You know, because we didn't read the rest of the story. Yeah. I mean, yeah. it's something as simple as thinking everything in the Bible, you know, everything in the Bible, you know, God said or God agrees with.
Yeah.
I mean, all you got to do is go to Job 42, verse 7. And God shows up to Job and his counselors and he says, I'm irritated with Eliphaz the Temanite because everything he said about me is not true. Well, that's pretty much Job 5 all the way to Job 42 right. is all Eliphaz the Temanite.
Right.
And so, you know how many sermons I heard growing up preaching from Job 5 to Job 42 and then saying, thus says the Lord with it. And yet God shows up in chapter 42 and says, I didn't say none of that.
Right.
You know, so it's like, you know, listen, man, read the whole story. All right. Don't, you know, but Americans, especially, and especially a lot of American teaching and preaching, we do what I call old McDonald theology, here a verse, there a verse, everywhere, verse. And the truth is you can pull verses out of the context and believe whatever you want.
Well, yeah, you can make scripture say anything. Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. You know, I mean, to just, you know, to get away with whatever I want or live however I want. But the beautiful thing about it is I have to show people that that wasn't talking about God, that when Jesus said that to John, I can almost hear Jesus explaining to John and James, listen, boys, I gave Elijah and Elisha a grace. I gave them a gift,
yeah.
an anointing to call fire out of heaven on sacrifices. But out of their own fear and insecurity, they started using their gifts on people. Hmm. Because and then we got blamed for it because we know God's not into calling fire out of heaven and yeah. destroying people because Jesus shows up and he's exactly like the Father.
Yeah, and, he's
like, you don't even know what spirit you are
yeah,
of.
Yeah.
So what was going on there? Well, when God gives a gift, he doesn't take it back. But how men use those gifts has everything to do with their own character, with their own insecurities. I mean, I've met people that have genuine prophetic gifts who completely like use their gifts to manipulate people.
Oh, yeah.
To go the way of Balaam and just go after money and start charging for prophecies and, you know, all kinds of other things. And it's a genuine gift that God gives. And when he gives it, he don't take it back. But how we use those gifts doesn't reflect on who God is. How we use those gifts reflects on who we are.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you got Elijah and Elisha. They're thinking these are the days of Elijah. And Jesus shows up and he's like, no, it ain't. These are the days of Jesus.
Yeah.
All right. You know, stop singing that dumb song. You know, he's like, you know, these are not the days of Moses or Elijah. These are the days of Jesus.
Right.
And so the beauty of seeing that God is light and he has no darkness. And one thing I've been teaching a lot over the last several years, I've actually been stuck in 1 John for almost 3 years.
Man, it's a good book.
I mean, man, I can't get out of 1 John. And the main reason is because 1 John is the only book in scripture that tells us in noun form who God is. John 1, God is light. John 2 and 3, God is life. John 2, 3, 4, and 5, God is love. Yeah. They're the only things that are nouns. Every other description of God are adjectives. You know, like anytime I go on social media and I'll say God is love.
Yeah.
There's always that person that says, yeah, but God is also holy.
Yeah.
And I have no problem answering him. I said, you're absolutely right. God is other. He is holy.
Yeah.
But holy and holiness is an adjective. And the purpose for an adjective is to further describe the noun.
Yeah.
And so God's holiness is based on his light, his life, his love.
Yeah.
You know, and then I always get the big one. Well, but God is just. And I'm like, there's no doubt, but just and justice is an adjective.
Yeah.
So God's justice is based on his love. And even in the Old Testament, we're told in Zechariah 7:9 or 9:7, I always get those two mixed up, but that practice true justice declares the Lord, which is mercy and compassion. So God's idea of justice is not punitive, it's restorative.
Yes.
And his idea of justice is mercy and compassion. And then the number one verse, and when you and I were trying to do this a couple of days ago, you even brought this out, I think it's Isaiah 55. You know, it's a verse that we use all the time when we don't know how to explain God. When someone asks us a question and we don't have the answer, we're like, well, I don't know about that. All I know is God's ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. But when you go back to the context and you read the verses before, it's actually God talking, Isaiah prophesying about God's mercy on the wicked. And then he goes on to say, for my thoughts are higher than yours. My ways are higher than yours. Wow. In other words, what God was saying is, I'm nicer than you are. Okay. you want retribution.
Right.
You know, I mean, let's be honest. Most of us, if we were on the cross, we would have called for the angels to wipe everybody out. I mean, our normal gut human response is not, Father, forgive them.
Especially where we are today. Yeah.
Well, yeah, it's sick 'em, Daddy. Yeah. And you know, and that's the crazy, the beauty of grace and the good news of the cross. The good news is, you know, it's not an announcement that Jesus came to change the Father's mind about us. It's that he came to change our mind about the Father.
Jeez, that's it.
You know, came to reveal who Abba is. And, you know, when we tried to do this a couple of days ago, the one thing that I was heading towards, we got cut off because your internet went out.
Yeah.
Was just this whole idea. And I told you about a good friend of mine. He coined a phrase called Abbaology.
Yes.
And actually, he was almost done with his book. And then when I got this and shared it with him, he kind of went back to the drawing board because he felt like he had to add it in there.
Yeah.
But what's interesting is the one thing that Jesus came to reveal. And let me get back to 1 John. All right. 1 John tells us that we have an advocate with the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay. Now, the problem with that is this is the crazy thing. Do you know the word advocate in the Greek is the Greek word paraclete?
Okay.
And paraclete, through the rest of the New Testament, is translated as helper or comforter.
Yeah.
So most of the translators chose to use the one definition of paraclete that is the one that is furthest down the page, which is advocate.
Okay.
Because most people that translated our Bibles were Calvinist.
Right.
Most of them were Reformed,
yeah,
who had a judicial view of God. They don't start with God as light, life, and love.
Right.
They start with God as holy and righteous and just. And so you can actually translate that verse. Rather than we have an advocate with the Father, we have a comforter.
Hmm.
We have a helper
hmm.
with the Father, that when we sin, we have a helper
wow.
who's faithful and just to forgive us. Well, wow. what? We have a comforter. Well, what does that mean? Well, he's there to comfort you in your sin? No. He's there to help you overcome your sin.
Wow.
He's there to comfort and remind you that he took your sins from
wow.
you. But when you translate that as advocate,
yep.
then it turns into like when I was a teenager.
A defense lawyer.
Absolutely. We had a youth Sunday, and we had one of the youth sit at a desk with a long beard and a gavel, and that was God sitting yep. on the throne.
I've been in that. I've been
right?
in that.
And there was Jesus at the right hand. He was the heavenly lawyer. They had me play the devil, and I was the prosecuting attorney, and someone yep. would walk up and I'd start persecuting them and condemning them. And Jesus would step in, push me out of the way and say, Father, you know, remember what I did. This is one of mine. And then he'd bring them towards him. And if the person never accepted Jesus, and I'd get to drag him into hell, the crazy thing is that picture doesn't exist.
Right.
First of all, Satan was cast out of heaven a long time ago.
Yeah.
So he doesn't have access. And the second part of it is God the Father is no longer a judge. We know this because Jesus said all judgment the Father has given to the Son.
Jeez.
So the idea of the Father sitting in a courtroom, which you right. know, that's a big thing sure. in the charismatic church right now.
Yep. Yep.
It literally doesn't exist in the new covenant because we're not coming into a courtroom. We come boldly to a throne of grace.
Yeah.
We're coming into the living room and Daddy's sitting on a big old lazy boy and he's saying, climb up in my lap yeah. and no wise will I cast you out.
Yeah.
The idea of the Father sitting there as a judge doesn't exist. Wow. Jesus is the only judge.
Yeah.
And you go a few chapters later and Jesus says, and I judge no man. So that's a whole
nother
question. Yeah, you know, and so, you know, the amazing
the judge who doesn't count sins, my friend.
Come on.
Yeah.
Think about it.
Yeah.
But he's up there writing everything we did wrong in books.
Right. The insanity comforter over advocate is huge.
Yeah. Well, how we interpreted that stuff from the book of Revelation, that any books that John the Revelator was talking about was all about, it was all about the temple. It was all about the tabernacle.
Yeah.
That literally when you would bring your sacrifice every year, they would write it down in a book called the Book of Life. You know, they would write it down. And if your name wasn't there, it's because you didn't bring your sacrifice that year.
Right.
I mean, They ain't got nothing to do with God writing a bunch of people's names down that are saved, and now those that aren't saved,
right,
and they get cast out. That was all talking about, is all Jewish stuff,
yeah,
talking about the destruction of the temple, which, right, of course, you know, that's a whole nother discussion in the book of Revelation.
Right.
But what's interesting to me is the more we understand that Jesus came to reveal, not God as judge, but God as Father.
Jeez.
If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. In my Father's house are many rooms. When you pray, you know, when you pray, and this is the crazy thing. He says, you know, John's disciples come to Jesus. They said, John taught us how to pray. Why don't you teach us how to pray? He said, when you pray, pray our Father. Now, notice who he was telling this to. He was telling this to unredeemed, unborn again.
Right.
Nobody was saved yet because the cross hadn't taken place.
Right.
The new covenant hadn't kicked in. And so he's telling a bunch of unredeemed people that God was their Father. In other words, they were sons who just didn't know they were sons. I mean, that's the beauty of the gospel.
Yeah.
Is not your sinship, it's your sonship.
Yeah.
You know, it's reminding you, awake to righteousness and sin not.
Yeah.
Well, we taught people for years, stop sinning and then you'll awake to righteousness. He's like, no, your job is to awaken people to the fact that according to Romans 5, because of one man's unrighteous deed, all were made righteous. Our job is to now let them know that they're righteous because of what Jesus did.
Yeah.
And then the moment they believe that, they're going to start living righteous because now they're going to think righteous.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
it's behavior follows identity.
Come on. Yeah. It's the same picture of, you know, the Holy Spirit taking Peter up to the rooftop and giving him a revelation to call no man unclean.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
If you sit and meditate on that for just 5 minutes, I mean, God tells them not to call any human unclean.
Yeah.
You know, so why do we have all these people acting unclean? Yeah. It's because they don't believe they're clean.
Which,
they don't,
by the way, predicates the statement, God shows no partiality.
Right? Hello. Hello. Exactly.
Yeah.
But now, this is the beautiful part I want to get to.
In Cornelius's house, for those listening.
Yeah, exactly.
Go ahead.
And Jesus's whole ministry was to reveal this Father heart of God. So how did we get so jacked up? I mean, in our views of God.
Yeah.
You have to go back to Genesis 1. In Genesis 1, it says that God created everything. Now, the word for God there is Elohim, which is Lord, Master, Sovereign, King, Ruler. Okay. So when he reveals himself to the world, to the animal kingdom, the plant kingdom, the earth, he's the ruler. But when he creates man on the sixth day, he calls himself Lord God. Now, if you go to a concordance, it'll say like Jehovah or Yahweh Elohim. But when you have discussions with Orthodox Jews, Judaism for thousands of years, because they don't say the name Jehovah or Yahweh, because they're the most holy names of God, and they're unpronounceable because they have no vowels.
Okay.
You know, I mean, it's like Jiva or Yiwa.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you can't even say the name anyway. Orthodox Jews for thousands of years have passed down orally. And if anybody's interested, I have like the source for this and I could send you an email.
Okay.
Because people are always asking for sources nowadays, which is good.
Yeah.
And, but they believe that actually what God called himself to Adam, to mankind, was Hashem Elohim. Now, Hashem to a Jew, like I've been to a few bar mitzvahs, and when you're at a bar mitzvah, you actually hear the word Hashem quite a bit. It's a family name. It's a relational comfort name. They'll call their father's Hashem, uncle's Hashem, cousin's Hashem. But the name Hashem for God is always Abba. It's Papa. Wow. And so when God reveals himself to humanity, he doesn't call himself Lord and Master.
Yeah.
He calls himself Father Ruler.
Yeah.
And so matter of fact, to such a degree, and this, man, this is so stinking powerful, man. This has rocked me in the last couple of years.
Yeah.
To such a degree, the first thing that God does in Genesis with man, after he breathes the breath of life into him, after he puts, you know, makes him of the clay of the earth, he then, it says, and God blessed them and said, be fruitful, multiply, replenish, subdue, and have dominion. What's called the dominion mandate, I call it the grace mandate because it's five things. Plus the word bless there, it's the first time you'll find in scripture, it's actually one of the seven Hebrew words for praise. It's the Hebrew word barak. And I always tell people this is way before there was a President Obama. So the first thing God did with humanity is they didn't do anything. They didn't do any work. The first thing God did is he blessed them.
Right.
That word Barak, it literally is translated to bend the knee and bow, to worship, to affirm, to bless, to praise. So the first thing the creator does with his creation is he bows before them.
Wow.
He blesses them.
Wow.
He affirms them. He praises them. Yeah. And I remember back in the 90s, I did the seven Hebrew words of praise over like three Wednesday nights for my dad at his church in Michigan. And that's the first word praise I found. And I didn't do anything with it because it felt blasphemous. You know,
you felt like what?
It felt blasphemous.
Right, right. Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
what do you mean God, the creator, doesn't bow before his creation? Right. And then it dawned on me that when Jesus shows up,
that's what he does.
He said, I've not come to be served. Jeez. I've come to serve.
Yeah.
Well, in other words, daddy and I, because I don't say anything but that which I hear my father say. I do nothing but that which I see my father do.
Yeah.
So my daddy and I are not here to be served. We're here to serve because guess what? It's my father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom.
Yeah.
And then it hit me. All right. My granddaughters live 60 feet from me. Okay. My oldest granddaughter, she would come over to my house and she'll walk in the door. And there's times I'll say to her, hey, Katie, would you go downstairs and get Papa a root beer? I mean, I love IBC root beer. I've always got a refrigerator full downstairs. And no, most of the time she said no. You know, she didn't want to do that.
Right.
But then within 5 minutes, Papa, I want some Lucky Charms. Papa, would you give me one of these? Papa, would you do this? And I immediately get up and start serving her.
Right.
Why? Because fathers serve their children.
Yeah, that's right.
And the heart of a creator would be to serve his creation, not to lord over his creation. And then during the pandemic in June of 2020 is when my second granddaughter was born. And we couldn't go to the birthing room to see her. We had to wait till my daughter brought her home.
Right.
My daughter brings her home and she's in the car seat. And this papa, this Abba, I get down on my hands and my knees.
Yeah.
And I get right up to her face and I start rubbing those little soft cheeks and I kiss those cheeks and I start telling her how beautiful she is and how awesome she is. Yeah. I begin to affirm her and praise her.
Yeah.
And bless her.
Yeah.
And I'm here to serve her destiny. She's not here to serve me.
That's it.
And yet, if that's how Heavenly Father is, and Jesus said, if you being evil would give good gifts to your kids, how much more the Heavenly Father? And so this idea that God's first response to us was to affirm and to bless and to praise and to reveal himself as Father Creator.
Yeah.
That I want a relationship. This is what this is about. So how did everything get so jacked up? Well, a serpent came in the garden.
Right.
And notice the first thing the serpent said, has not Elohim said.
Yeah.
He drops the Hashem.
Yeah. Wow.
So he deceives them into believing that God's not your father. He's a master and a ruler that you have to serve.
Oh, come on.
Now you see, it's never that we, as children, don't serve our parents. When we get older, we also, I mean, you know, when my kids got to a certain age, I expected them to clean their room and help mow the lawn.
Sure.
But they only serve us because we first serve them.
Yeah.
All right. We love him because he first.
That's it. That's my favorite verse. No.
Yeah. I mean, he's the example of the servant leader. Yeah. He's the example of a father who serves the destiny of his family and cares for his family. But the serpent deceived them into believing that God was not father creator,
bro,
but master.
Bro.
And then says to them, and what did God say to you? Well, if you eat of this tree, you'll be like God, which we know they were already like God in his image and likeness. So the ultimate deception, which of course the word sin, hamartia in Greek, when you go back to its root form, it means to live or believe a lie.
Yeah.
And so the root of sin is mistaken identity in the first place.
That's it.
And so this is what I tell people. Everything you read then in scripture, back to God is light, in him there's no darkness at all.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
In a roundabout way.
Yes.
But from Genesis 4 all the way to John 1, everything written is inspired by God. God breathed on men to write it, but it was written through the lens of servants and slaves.
Bro, come on.
Trying to figure out how to have a relationship with the master.
Yep.
Not sons and daughters enjoying fellowship with the father.
Come on.
Okay. So now when I read stuff in the Old Testament that makes God out to look like he's nothing like Jesus, I can say, okay, now I understand. This was slaves trying to figure out how to explain a relationship with a master, because a slave would think the master is there to harm them. The master's there to take stuff from them.
Right.
But a son would never think a father would do that to him.
Bro.
And so it cleared up for me, like Genesis to Revelation.
Yeah.
I mean, it was like,
come on.
That little Hashem piece for me has been a massive, massive shift. And it's a lot of what I preach almost everywhere I go.
Bro, I got it. I finished a book. It's just come out called Leaving and Finding Jesus. Chapter 11 is He Calls Us Friends.
Yeah.
Again, I'm a storyteller. I write through the lens of relational God relationship, right? We've talked about that. Yeah. So you're hitting on what this whole chapter was about. And it was like the huge shift for me. I've said this often. Was Jesus the most obedient person in the world, or did he only do what he desired in his heart to do? And I'm like, the answer is yes, but it depends on what lens you want to look at it through. And the point is I use this scripture, the passion says, as a non-academic, my point was, look, I don't know, because I've not done the study like you have. You just did the study. Thank you. But I said, I haven't done the study. It's not how I'm wired, but the passion version is the right version. And I know it based on how love works. And the passion version says this: I never called you servant. I call you most beloved friends.
Yeah.
My point being this, I used the example of me with my kids, but I said, you know, there was never master slave language before the fall. There's no master slave language in heaven.
Come on.
And it didn't exist in the relationship Jesus had with the Father.
Come on.
Jesus came to reveal what it looked like to live sure as a son in the context of friendship.
Yes, sir.
And it's the same thing. It was like a huge shift for me was the idea. But how you just take us to Old Testament and how you just did that, man, is freaking brilliant. Because for me, that idea right there, that we have a bunch of people inspired by God trying to explain how to interact with God from a perspective of a slave or a servant.
Yep.
And then, of course, I spent a lot of time in that chapter talking about what a servant really is in the context of family. And it looks like Jesus. It looks like laying your life down. And of course, I used some of the same type of analogies of me as a dad laying my life down for my kid, vice versa.
I've said for years that the kingdom of God is not a kingdom of servants.
Jeez.
It's a kingdom of sons who choose to serve.
Yes.
It's just a whole different mentality.
Yeah. That serving is. So the point being that serving then becomes the fruit of intimacy. It becomes the obvious hello of man, dude, I could dive into this with you for a while because from there I go into equality and finally justice, the last three chapters. So it's he no longer calls us servants. He calls us friends is the chapter. Then we've talked about a little bit about equality in the sense that Jesus is the revelation of equality. And you basically talked about equality being that equality starts with a God who lays his life down for, like, at the very beginning of this story.
Yeah.
The way that you've just defined worship and praise is that he serves. That's where you discover what true equality is. The idea that we love because he first loved. It's a response. And then you start to redefine justice as restorative.
Man, yes, sir.
That's so good.
Yes, sir. Yeah. No. And for me, one of the things I love about Eastern Orthodoxy and Eastern thought is one of their pillars of the faith is beauty.
Wow.
And, you know, they're what they would say by that is this, is if the message we preach and how we live, our neighbors should be able to look at us and watch how we interact with our wife and our kids.
That's it.
And with other people and the life we live and what we preach. And they should be able to say, I might not agree with him.
Yeah.
But that's beautiful.
Yeah.
And, you know, I wasn't raised with a beautiful message. I mean, turn or burn.
Yeah.
You know, the idea of God can't even look at you. He can't stand you. He's disgusted with you. You know, he wants to fry you until, you know, you all of a sudden get hid in Jesus. And
right.
Because he actually can't stand anything about you, even though you're in his image and likeness, you know, he don't want anything about you. And as long and we interpreted that verse that said our life is hid with God in Christ as our life is hid from God in Christ.
Right.
You know, and so as long as I'm behind Jesus and he's looking at Jesus, he's good with me. But if I step out from Jesus, man, he just wants to hit me with lightning bolts. I mean, there's no good news in that. I mean, it's horrible.
No, you know? Compromises everything. Compromises.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Well,
and it completely. And this is one thing the Holy Spirit said to me now about 12 years ago. He said, you know, everywhere you go, because I travel extensively, I'm on the road. At least 48 weekends out of the year.
Yeah, it looks
like. The other 4 weekends, I'm preaching at my home church.
Yeah.
So I'm preaching pretty much 52 Sundays out of the year.
Yeah.
And then I'm gone about 28 full weeks. I mean, whether it's overseas or so, I mean, I preach a couple hundred times a year at least. But he said, everywhere you go, unless it's like an apostolic function, like to ordain or, you know, do something like that. So there's two things I want you to accomplish. Number one, I want you to remove all fear-based theology.
I love it.
Because fear and love cannot coexist.
Yeah.
Number two, wow. Which is one of the only reasons I even bring up Satan. That's the number one fear-based theology.
Right. Yeah.
Is hell, Satan, and everything else.
Yeah.
And then number two, repaint the Father to the church.
Wow.
Because, you know, a lot of people are like the Doobie Brothers with Jesus. Jesus is just all right with me.
Sure.
But they're still terrified of his dad. Sure.
Yeah.
You know, but it's because of us misunderstanding how to interpret the Old Testament.
Right.
You know, God breathed doesn't mean God even agreed with it.
Right.
I mean, did God breathe on Moses saying an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth? Sure he did.
Yeah.
But Jesus shows up.
He redefines it.
And he says, Daddy and I didn't agree with that.
Right.
You know, because you heard said, but I say. But but when you understand that when Moses said that almost 1800 years earlier, that what was in place in ancient antiquity was if someone harmed you, you not only went after them, you took their whole family out.
Right.
So when Moses made that a law, you know, God still didn't say, you know, that's really not where I want you to be, but that's going to move you along further, closer to the kingdom, which is righteousness, peace, and joy.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so I'm going to breathe on that to help you move forward. I mean, the idea of, you know, one of the most horrifying verses in the Bible is Deuteronomy, I think it's 32 or 34, one of those. And it says, if you go to a city and it doesn't submit to you, kill the men, take the women and children as your slaves, but then take all the virgins, bring the virgins into your home, dress them up like an Israelite till they're done grieving. If you decide you like them, marry them and keep them in your house. If not, put them out of the house, but then tithe a tithe of the virgins to the priesthood, you know, which for years I've tried to figure out what the priest did with them, but that's, you know, I don't even know if I want to go there in my mind.
Right.
Well, we look at that today and our young people, when they leave home and they go to a university, and they take one philosophy class.
Yeah.
The professor goes to those verses because they'll take a whole class to try to destroy the Bible. All right. And they'll go to those verses like,
sure,
you know, Samuel, God told David the number of Israel. Over here, he's telling the same story. It says Satan. So is God Satan? And then students get confused because we taught them the Bible is inerrant and infallible. It's perfect. It has no contradictions. And we taught them how to be Biblians rather than Christians.
Yeah.
A lot of times.
Jeez, that's the truth. Yeah.
And taught them how to have a relationship with a book rather than a relationship with the Godhead.
Yeah.
And then they'll take them to passages like that in Deuteronomy and say, so your God never changes, but your God's okay with sex slaves? And that's horrifying to people.
Sure it is.
Until you understand the difference between God saying it and God breathing on it. Now, when God breathed on it, I actually heard a well-known sociologist, a woman, say, when Moses made that a law, it actually moved women's rights 1,000 years into the future. Hmm. Because up until that time, now we look at it 5,000 years later and say, that's immoral. That's just horrible.
Right.
But if you were a virgin girl living in Moses' day, normally when your city was ransacked, you were raped and just killed. But when Moses made that law, now not only are you not raped and killed, you either become a wife or you're set free or you serve in the temple, but you get to live a full life.
Right.
So Moses was their hero. You know, we look at Moses today and say, man, that guy's jacked up.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's some messed up stuff.
Yeah.
So it's not an issue on whether God agreed with it or that God said it.
Yeah.
But God was trying to move ancient, polytheistic, superstitious, ignorant. I mean, there was a 90% illiteracy rate in most of the world.
Right.
I mean, people were they still believe the earth was flat.
Sure.
You know, I'd like to put it like this. Imagine, you know, God shows up one day and Joshua is in a battle and he cries out to God and he said, God, in order to win this battle, I need you to have the sun stand still. Now, notice what God doesn't say. He doesn't say, listen, son, you're a moron. The sun always stands still.
Right.
You know, I mean, Galileo hadn't been born yet. You know, I mean,
they believed
the sun revolved around the earth.
Yeah.
Well, we know today it's the earth that revolves around the sun.
Yeah.
But if God would have tried to explain that to a guy in the middle of a battle.
Sure.
And it would have blew his mind. He wouldn't have comprehended it, and he wouldn't have believed it was God even telling him that.
Yeah. Yeah. He speaks to us in the language of our understanding. Yeah.
Right. Instead of, you know, God trying to correct him, God just has the earth stand still and makes him think the sun stood still. That's called grace. All right. That's God saying, listen, man, I'm going to bless your stupidity. All right. I mean, I always tell people there's a reason why Psalm says God sits in the heavens and he laughs. Man, he's laughing at all us trying to explain him. I mean, he's probably laughing at this podcast right now saying, nah, you got that one wrong. I mean, you know, I mean, we as finite
exactly, man. Yeah.
people trying to explain the infinite. You know, it's crazy.
Here's the, I think I could talk with you all day because we're having these, we're tracking the same roads. I got there very differently. Yeah. I had to get there differently, but it's the same thing when I tell the story about, you know, Abraham and Isaac, and sacrifice. I'm like, if you understood that during Abraham's day, that sacrifice was the high watermark of worship. Like if you open the dictionary, you would find in it the definition. High watermark of worship is that you would sacrifice that which is most valuable to your firstborn.
Absolutely.
And so the paradigm, you know, this story, I grew up under the abusive idea that this story was about Abraham's ability to obey a depraved demand from God, as opposed to the story being told through that slave lens or that servant lens that you've talked about. And it's a story about a man who in Hebrews tells us that by faith, in the context of his understanding at that point in time, and it was fractured and broken, believed a depraved idea about God, but was able to, and this is what faith is to me, was able to go, I don't know, but he's good enough to raise the dead.
Yeah.
Like, so what really took place there was a man going, I'm living in the context of my reality, my history, this moment in time and space where I understand what I understand and I'm limited by my understandings. And in that place, I'll believe that he's better than my ability to understand.
Good.
And that's what really is taking place there. But it allowed me, when I got that on that story, I was suddenly able to navigate all kinds of Old Testament stories, realizing, hey, they're doing the best they can in the moment they're in without the revelation of Jesus, without the revelation of Father. And so give them a break. It's all inspired.
Well, and they didn't have scripture.
They didn't have,
literally, I mean, Abraham was an Akkadian from Northern Iraq that the first 40 years of his life, everybody offered their firstborn to the God. So, you know, he's following this Elohim, this Yahweh, this God who says he's the God of all the other gods. And when he asks him to do that, he doesn't even argue with him.
Right.
He's like, well, sure, that's what all the gods do. But then God's like, but listen, I actually don't want you to do that.
Right.
I'm just showing you a lesson.
Yes.
Yeah. I like obedience rather than sacrifice because I'm not a bloodthirsty vampire, for crying out loud.
Yeah. And I'd like you to be free of that nonsense.
Come on.
Right. That's the thing that's beautiful, because like you said, I grew up with you have to read scripture as though, okay, God said, so it must define what God is like.
Right.
And now I'm stuck having to do mental gymnastics around a God who would require this of Abraham. What? So, again, it comes back to obedience is what we're looking for, regardless of how depraved the request is.
Yeah, I've said for years, I don't care if I got 60 prophetic words and I heard God's audible voice 100 times telling me to kill my son. I'm going to say, nope. I'm going to say, if you want my son dead, you're going to have to kill him, because I ain't doing that to my kid. That's jacked up.
That's right. And we're not as good as our Heavenly Father that Jesus revealed. That's it, bro. Man, okay. Got to tell us, we're 119. We're over an hour. I already have the feeling we could be here another two if I didn't shift us. I said last time we talked, and we'll have to do this again, I didn't get to all my questions. I think I got to one question this time. I want you to talk about, you've got a conference coming up. You got Paul Young. I want you to talk about your ministry, where we find you. And then we got to talk tacos for a half second.
Absolutely. All right. Yeah. Okay. You can go to my website, which is himconnect.net, himconnect.net. Super easy. People can find me on Facebook. I think I'm also on Twitter and Instagram. I don't know how much I use those.
Right.
I still am 55, man. I mean, when I was a senior in high school, I was one of the guys carrying the personal computers into the building because we were just finally getting some, you know. So, I mean, I wasn't raised in the information age. I'm learning, growing with it. So someone can, I always tell people they normally can't send me a friend request because that stays pretty full. But they can either, they can like and follow me.
Yep.
And I also have a public figure page with my same name.
Yeah.
And I put the same content on there. I mainly do a lot more on Facebook than anything.
Yeah.
I have e-courses on there. You can get my book on Amazon and Kindle. I also have an audio book on my website with commentary. And so with that one, I not only read every myth, but I actually give a 3 to 5 minute additional.
Book is called 70 Misconceptions About God in the Bible, right?
Yeah. Well, it's called Myths and Mistranslations. And then it talks about 70 misconceptions.
That's right.
It's the kind of the underlying part. Then every year in May, the Thursday, Friday, and Saturday after Mother's Day, we have our yearly conference here in the Louisville area this year. It's called The Father's Heart.
Love it.
We've got William Paul Young that wrote The Shack is our main speaker, yeah, along with myself. And then part of our team with our network, but everybody's invited to that. It's like our yearly network gathering, but it's open also to the public. I do a separate thing during the year for just the ministers.
Yeah.
I've got right now 5-6 e-courses up there. I have one on how to understand the Bible, where I actually go over a lot of this about how to interpret through the Old Testament.
Yeah.
That's very interesting for people.
Yeah.
I have one called A More Complete Gospel, where I go over the 7 things called the gospel in the New Testament, and show that it's so much bigger than just the gospel of grace or just the gospel of the kingdom. And then I have one called What the Hell? And that's a 6-hour course. I walk people through history, the history of hell. I mean, where do we get all these ideas from?
Yeah.
And then one called Eschatology, The Last Days. And I go over the 4 major views of the last days and then give what I call a grace eschatology. Based more on the heart of the Father. And so if anybody's interested, they can go to my website and check that out.
Rethinking God with Tacos. It sounds like you probably have some good tacos in your family at this point. But
yeah, well, the one we always tease my son-in-law because the one Mexican thing about him, because he was actually raised by a white mom.
Okay.
So like my daughter's more Mexican than he is. We tease him all the time. But the one thing he's got down is chorizo. Listen. I mean, he makes a chorizo and egg with cheese.
Oh, I'm hungry now.
Like breakfast taco that's out of this world.
It's
it's absolutely one of my favorites. But I've had tacos everywhere. Now my favorite like Mexican period is Papasitas. Yeah. Which is all in Texas. Like when I mainly fly American because I'm, status with American, 1 million miles.
Okay,
American.
Yeah, sure.
And
sure.
So they normally have me go through Charlotte, which I'll see you in March here.
Yeah,
that's go right. through Charlotte or go through Dallas. And if I have a choice, I'm going through Dallas every time because there's a Papasitas at A29, I think, and there's a Papasitas at like C17. I actually know where exactly they are. And I'll go through there and I'll get my tacos and fajitas. It's literally, that's.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, I actually determine some of my flying on getting a taco. But, 33 years of traveling, man, I'm a foodie. I get taken out to eat for a living.
Yeah, that's right.
You just kind of, you got your favorite little places all over the country you like to go. So
that's the best part of some of the best things about travel. Absolutely. I've learned that a little bit, not like you, but yeah. I've learned when you write a book, it's not a bad idea to note like that you're a pie, you like this particular pie or that particular taco, because it works out for you when you're traveling.
It's true. Yeah, everybody will bring you that. It's true.
Yeah, or take you somewhere. It's pretty good. Appreciate you, man. This has been rich. There's a lot here, bro. You're a deep well. Thankful for you. Thankful that we've gotten to connect a little bit and I'm getting to know you a little bit too.
Sure.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Hey guys, we're so glad that you are joining us. You can find me, Derek Turner, at rivercharlotte.com. That's my church. And I'm on all the social medias as Pastor Derek T. D-E-R-E-K, Pastor Derek T.
I'm also on Twitter at Jason Clark Is. And you can find all of these podcasts, including season 1, on all of the platforms, Apple, Spotify,
all the places.
You can also go to afamilystory.org. And everything's there. If you sign up for our mailing list, we send out a weekly email that has articles, podcast information, and we also let you know about new books coming out or events that we're connected to. So like, share, retweet, and man, if you could write a review, it actually does something for the rankings. It
does.
It more available. So.
But a 5-star review, of course.
Yes.
You know, if you can't write a 5-star review or something, like, just don't even write a review.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's kind of like if you can't say something nice,
don't say anything at all. I like that. And then apply that to this podcast, definitely.
That's my motto.
I love it. So, love you guys. Appreciate you coming on the ride with us. God bless.